Now, as we move into chapter 9 here, God knew Israel, and their past was not good. Listen to this as we move into this chapter. Hear, O Israel, thou art to pass over Jordan this day. He's not talking now about the 24-hour day, but they've now come to that time when they're going to enter the land. You're to go in to possess nations greater and mightier than thyself, cities great and fenced up to heaven, a people great and tall, the children of the Anakims, whom thou knowest and of whom thou hast heard say, who can stand before the children of Anak? God's report of the land is worse than the spies that came back. You see, God knew the land, and God knew who was in there. God told them to go in. They wouldn't go in. Why? They didn't believe God. God says, sure, they're greater than you are, but I'm with you. Martin Luther put it like this. He says, one with God is a majority. My friend, if you are with God, you're with the majority. Now, I belong to a minority group down here today, but I'm going to let you in on something. The world doesn't know it, but I'm with the majority today. You see, one with God is a majority. I want to be with him, friends. Now, will you notice as he moves on here, he says, understand therefore this day that the Lord thy God is he which goeth over before thee as a consuming fire. He'll destroy them. You want to blame God for that, my friend? He takes the responsibility. God says, I'm the one put them out. God's the landlord. He's the creator. God has a right to do this. And after all, the little creatures today, when I hear a liberal complain about this, I just feel like saying, you little pipsqueak, you keep quiet. You and I are just little creatures down here. He's the creator, and if he says he's going to do it this way, he's going to do it that way, and you and I can't stop him, friends. He shall bring them down before thy face, so shalt thou drive them out and destroy them quickly, as the Lord hath said unto thee. Verse 4, speak not thou in thine heart, after that the Lord thy God hath cast them out from before thee, saying, for my righteousness the Lord hath brought me in to possess this land. But for the wickedness of these nations the Lord doth drive them out from before thee. In other words, God says that he drove them out because they were wicked nations, not because the people he were putting in there were righteous. They were not, as this chapter makes it abundantly clear. And he goes on, verse 5, not for thy righteousness, or for the uprightness of thine heart, dost thou go to possess their land, but for the wickedness of these nations, the Lord thy God doth drive them out from before thee, and that he may perform the word which the Lord sware unto thy fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And you know the reason that God will save you and me? It's not because we're good, we're sinners. But he saves us because Christ died for us, and God says, I agreed to save them, and it's for Christ's sake we're saved, friends, not for our sake. Oh, if you are listening today and you think somehow or another that God's looking for something in you that will merit salvation, you forget it, because you're going to be disappointed. And God already knows you, and he says he can't find anything there. No righteousness at all. It's for Christ's sake that God saves you, and God finds everything in him. How wonderful it is. You see, you have here the seed for the gospel of the grace of God in this remarkable section of Scripture. Now, he again repeats it, verse 6, understand, therefore, that the Lord thy God giveth thee not this good land to possess it for thy righteousness. Listen, for thou art a stiff-necked people. God didn't come down and deliver them because they were a wonderful people. He said, well, I knew all the time you were stiff-necked people. I heard you cry. And my friend, if you're a sinner, know it. And you lift a cry to him for salvation, he'll hear you. You know why? Not because of who you are, but for Christ's sake. And he'll turn to Christ in faith. He'll save you.